And I said more than once that I think leadership starts in the home.
Right, right.
And then I gave you an example of a big raggedy family in David.
Yeah.
And then Sunday night, I gave you what I believe is the basic tool for guiding families in any context. And then last night we did a biblical basis for leadership, kind of looking at roles and the importance of those roles. And I left this, I started to erase it when I came in, but opted to leave it just so you'll remember. And I didn't do a complete job here, and I know that. But all I was trying to help you see is the importance of roles and trying to pull us away from thinking so much like the carnal world, so that Miriam and Moses, or Aaron would say Moses has too much authority, or the Kohathites would say, we can do something other than all of God's people are holy. You know, all that kind of stuff that really messes us up in terms of spiritual alignment with the will of God. And I was about to cross over on the other side to the New Testament side, and I looked at the clock, and all the time it was gone. And so I just kind of quit and left this hanging. But I'm going to cross over tonight in a kind of interesting way. I've told you before that the basic formula from Old Testament to New Testament is, if you come over here to the Old Testament, then do 12 minus 1 plus 2. You can do it on both sides, and you'll have a pretty good way to get from one side to the other. What's that formula about? Do you remember? Or did I tell you? I didn't tell you. Okay. No, you don't remember then. Okay. It'll be over here, there's 12 sons of Jacob. Jacob's got 12 boys. What we're trying to do is make a nation. And when you begin to make that nation, Old Testament nation, take the 12 sons of Jacob minus Joseph. Plus, when Joseph was sold off into Egypt, Pharaoh gave him an Egyptian wife named Asenath. And by Asenath, he had Ephraim and Manasseh. And if you look at that closely and you do the math, what's 12 minus 1 plus 2?
13.
Huh?
13.
About 13. That's really 13. So why do we keep talking about the 12 tribes of Israel if there are really 13 tribes? Because that special tribe that we learned a little bit about last night.
Tribe.
Which one?
Kohath.
Special tribe.
Oh, Levi.
Levites. Because the Levites don't belong to us. The Levites belong to God because God bought them when he brought the children of Israel up out of the land of Egypt. He asked for the firstborn, and then he traded the firstborn for the Levites. And that's how you kind of make the nation 12 minus 1 plus 2. But what's interesting about this is right up through persecution, no matter what they say or do, God raises up a nation. Pharaoh decided that the Israelites were multiplying too fast in Egypt. So he placed taskmasters over them to make them work harder so they wouldn't multiply so fast.
Right.
Then guess what the Bible said?
They multiplied even more.
The harder they work, the more they multiply. So he told the Hebrew midwives, kill all the boy babies. Hebrew midwives said,
they deliver before
we can't quite do that because Egyptian women are different from the Hebrew women. The Hebrew women have babies fast. By the time we get in there, the baby's already born. We can't take the baby from the mom and kill it. But they really didn't kill the babies because they feared the Lord.
Right.
And the Bible says, so the Lord gave them houses.
Right.
So whatever Egypt tries, backfires. So they said, put all the boy babies in the Nile River. Amram and Jochebed feared God. They loved their child. They didn't want to put him in the Nile River. Kept him for a while. Finally put him out in the Nile River. And that's the very person that led the children of Israel up out of the land. It's God. All right. Only thing that's, the reason that's intriguing to me is if you come over here on the New Testament side, it's the 12 apostles of Jesus Christ minus Judas
plus
Paul and Matthias, and right up through persecution, no matter what they do to the church, they can't stop that church from growing. It's kind of like the more they persecute them, the more they grow, so that God's people under the authority of God keep going. These in both sides, these underdog kind of people, if you will, who just have good faith in God, and God keeps doing something for them. Well, when you move to this New Testament side, we got over here for, and I talked about the evangelist, the elders, and the deacons. And the reason I did that is because that's what we're the most familiar with. I have no problem at all in leadership with church leaders saying we have ministry leaders over areas that we have needs, or somebody who wants to add a teacher in as a leader. But I might tell you in passing that those are not authoritative leaders. You understand what I'm saying? So we've got to keep remembering that as we go through. And I'll show you two or three other things about that in just a little while. But what I will argue is that this divided into roles. Did you hear me? Divided into roles and responsibilities ought to function just as harmoniously as any other organizational structure that God made. This should work fine. So what I want to do is talk to you about this a little while, even stick in some roles and responsibilities of these people and talk about that. And then kind of like I did last night, I'll show you tonight what causes the problem. Your problem will never come from people doing what God authorizes them.
Amen.
That will never make a problem. You're going to get a problem when somebody deviates from that or gets out of their lane, or that's where you're going to get a headache. And I'll show you that in history, and that's what I want to do tonight. And so let me kind of plunge in before our time runs. Anybody not with me, raise your hand if you're lost. I don't mind you being lost. I just mind you staying lost. Because, I mean, if you just sit there and don't say anything, I won't know you're lost. You look at me like you look like you understand. To me, you look like you understand. And so I'll just take it like that. All right, look at the book of 1 Timothy. And I'm coming to 3. But I want to go back to 1. And you hang tight with me here for just a minute. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope, unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest ordain elders and deacons. I was just messing that up a little bit because one, I wanted to see if you were listening, and I'm glad you are. But I wanted to also point out that a major reason for Paul's address to Timothy in Ephesus is he wanted an evangelist down there, a preacher, to help them stay sound in the faith in the church in Ephesus.
Right.
Not necessarily to ordain elders and deacons, but that you might charge certain men that they teach no other doctrine, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies which minister questions rather than godly edifying, which is in faith, so do. Now the end of the commandment, that's the other verse I want you to underline. The end of that charge, I charge you for that purpose. And what I was really after is charity or love out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and a faith unfeigned. That's the point of leaving you there and helping for you to help the church develop the sound doctrine. Because some, having swerved, have turned aside unto vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm. So, problem in Ephesus. We're needing sound doctrine, and we're needing to say something to these people who have swerved and turned aside from sound doctrine. That's the way he ends. There are people there named Hymenaeus and Alexander who've already turned aside. Mm-hmm. And then when you get to chapter 2, he wants them to pray for the dignitaries and a lot of things I can say about that. But verse number 7, Paul describes himself as a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles.
Right.
He starts that with women, verse number 9. This is how women ought to conduct themselves. And I wish you would read that, because that says something about leadership and order that a lot of people don't want to hear today, but it's still true.
Amen.
That women ought to learn in silence, not utter silence, you can't sing, and that's how it is. But women ought to learn in silence and subjection, and he gives a reason. And I'm going to point up this reason and keep going. Because today some people are saying that passages like 1 Corinthians 14, let the women keep silence in the assembly. People are saying that was a cultural thing just for the church at Corinth.
Uh-huh.
Let me show you why that's probably not true. Here, Paul says, I suffer not a woman to teach nor usurp authority, but to be in silence. For Adam was first formed, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being in transgression, being deceived was in transgression. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing, if they continue in faith, in charity, and holiness with sobriety. Now, if you go back and read 1 Corinthians, Paul would say, the woman ought to keep silence, and the law says that. In 1 Timothy, Paul goes back past the law to creation.
Right.
So that wouldn't be cultural, would it?
It's universal.
You got Corinthian church back to also said the law, all the way back to creation.
Right.
And in creation, the issue is that woman was first in sin and second in creation.
Mm-hmm.
They've got to deal with both of those. Mm-hmm. You say, well, man sinned too. I know all of that. But what I'm talking about is the rationale.
Mm-hmm.
The one that you're never going to get away from is that she was second in creation.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get bothered by that. Just stick with it. There's a purpose in what God is doing. I promise you there's a purpose in it. There's always been a purpose in it.
Mm-hmm.
We've got some women who are so gung-ho to take over that they don't appreciate the good purpose that God has given them.
Right, amen.
You know, sometimes you go back to creation, and when you go back to creation, I use it as a good illustration. Do you know that God gave man the right to every tree in that garden?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
There was just one tree that they didn't have the right to. Why are you so worried about the one tree with all those other trees out there? Why don't you just go eat from all the other trees?
We always
got right to every tree of the garden. Now listen carefully, including the tree of life.
Yes.
And we're so worried about the one tree that we done missed out on the best tree.
Yep, you're right.
And that's how it is sometimes, in my judgment, with women's roles and that kind of thing. We're so gung-ho to get women out of place in some churches and places and in the pulpit.
Come on, Richard.
That we have not even explored all the good things women can do.
Mm.
Now, I realize that I'm in Warren, Arkansas. And that I preach in Memphis, Tennessee. And that those folk in Memphis are a little crazier than the country people where I grew up. But right now, we've got all kind of problems in Memphis with the role of women. And can women wait on the Lord's Supper table? And can women read scripture and say prayer? I'm not talking about campus. I'm talking about in worship service. Can women do all of that stuff?
No.
And I'm saying that we'd better teach carefully why, because even in Warren, Arkansas, you'll be faced with the problem in 2 days if you don't keep teaching why you got to do it God's
way.
Amen.
It's crucial and it's very important. I want to quit, but I want to tell you one other thing. If women will follow these instructions, particularly with, you know, the two things, I wish a woman would say something to me about, see if I'm right about this. I've tried this in a bunch of places. Do you know the two things that women really, really need and want? See if I get this right. I took it from the Bible. They want
children.
The praises of their husband and the blessings of their children. That if my children rise up and bless my wife, and her husband praises her, that's what she really wants. Think about it. Just think about it. Sometimes we overlook what the Bible really says about stuff, and we cheat ourselves without thinking about it, chasing the world instead of God.
Amen. All right, preacher.
1 Timothy then, chapter 3, after he does the women in end of 2, he goes to chapter 3 and he starts talking about the bishop. That's an elder. And he gives these characteristics of an elder. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, and he goes through those. And then he gets to even the deacons, but after he says in verse 8, likewise the deacons, he says, even so must their wives be. True or false? Your teacher believes that some women disqualify their husbands as church leaders.
True.
That's very true. So you want to be a wife that actually makes it possible for your husband to serve as a leader.
Amen.
In the church.
Amen.
But there are ways you can mess that up really badly. I've seen situations where I thought, man, I wouldn't make him an elder because his wife's out of control and he can't do nothing with her.
Amen.
Who would have to do something with her? See, listen, women, you would have to do something with yourself.
Yeah.
And make it possible for your husband to serve as a leader in the church. Now, the reason I wanted you to see something here, there are two major little issues here. One is that when you look at the characteristics of an elder or a deacon, and you compare the list in 1 Timothy to the list in Titus, I already told you that Titus does not have a list of characteristics for deacons.
Right.
Because I think most of the churches on the island of Crete didn't have elders.
Right.
So Titus is left there to ordain elders in every city. And the other thing about the list is, I think the list were not cookie cutter lists. Okay. What I'm saying is, sometimes people use the list like checkpoint list.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go down through here and I'm going to check every qualification and just see if you meet the qualification at all to some extent. And while I believe the qualifications, characteristics are there, I think if God had been trying to say these lists are not variable in any way, he should have sent exactly the same list to both groups. He didn't send exactly the same list to both groups. They're very similar,
right?
But I think that just proves the point that the island of Crete needs the same kinds of men that we need in the church at Ephesus to serve as leaders in the church. So we're looking for men who are like this, these kinds of men.
All right.
Now, once you get there, I want to talk with you. Can just raise your hand. One thing I want to be very careful about is making those lists that disqualify anybody from being an elder in the church. That's what I've seen in the past. And when we go through some of the reasons for the changes here, I'll show you why that has happened in some context. But don't make it a checklist and then go down through there and say, all right, brother, you failed the test right here. You can't pass. You can't be it. You know, it's not designed to be that kind of checklist. Never was designed to be like that. And when we get to a point in a little while, I'll show you how I think we got that. And then sometimes people go through the list and say things like, he's not blameless. Well, don't make qualifications is what I'm saying. Blameless does not equal sinless.
Right.
If you're looking for a sinless leader,
never gonna have
you
one.
Can throw in the towel. It ain't gonna happen. But you should be able to find a man that no accusation can be brought against him that will just hold.
Right.
You might say, yeah, this brother sinned, but he repented of that sin. It's not a part of his life anymore. That's long past him, and all of us need to be praying, Lord, remember not the sins of my youth. That's the way it is. Then when we get to the evangelist, I want to show you one thing that I want you to remember. Why is Paul sending that to Timothy in the first place? Because I want you to charge those people to be careful with the doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
And the end of that charge is love and good faith and a good church.
Right? Yeah.
All right? I would hold, challenge this if you want to. I would hold that there's a possibility that Paul did not send the characteristics to Timothy in Ephesus for ordination necessarily. You thinking? Well, if he didn't send them for ordination, what else might he have sent them for? Now you're thinking about this doctrine and all of that. And how people ought to behave and not get away. You thinking about that? All right, look in chapter 3, verse number 14. These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of truth. Now that's a little bit misleading in that King James text. Anybody got another translation other than the, what do you have?
I have the New King James Version.
All right, I'd be interested in what the New King James Version does with verse 15. But if I tarry long, what?
I am delayed, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth.
All right, he changes it to you, except I think you ought to know that that's plural. So a little bit of better translation. I'm writing you so that if I don't get there when I expect to, when I want to, you will know, Timothy will know, how men ought to behave themselves in the church of God, which is the pillar and the ground of truth. So it's kind of like if you say, are these all necessarily for ordination? I say, no, I don't think so. I think Paul wanted Timothy to know in the context of sound doctrine and straightening the church up and keeping it straight and all that, how men are supposed to behave themselves in the house of God. Go.
Did
This, I mean, this translation, Living Bible?
Yeah, read that.
It says, I tarry alone that thou may know how to behave thyself.
Thyself. All right. It's really going to be how these ones ought to behave themselves. That's really what it's going to be. So that's why I know that we've got a little bit of an issue sometimes if we make it strictly for ordination. All right, here's another question. What's Paul supposed to do about it? Timothy supposed to do about it? If men don't behave themselves right. Let me tell you the answer. That's why I struggle if somebody says an evangelist has no authority. I'm going to come here in just a minute. That's why I struggle if you say that evangelist doesn't have any authority, because he's got to have some.
Right.
I want you to know how men are supposed to behave themselves. Well, what am I supposed to do about it if they don't behave themselves? Look over chapter 5, verse number 15. Now let's see, 17. Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in word and doctrine and teaching. For the scripture said, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, and the laborer is worthy of his hire. Against an elder, receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses. Let them that sin rebuke before all, that others may fear.
Right.
See, Paul says, Timothy, you've got a job to do. If those guys don't act right, you've got to correct that. If nobody ever corrects that, the church can never be put in order.
Right.
Question, comment about that? Let me just stick in one for you, one of the little teaching things. You see that two or three witnesses?
Right.
That always reminds me of something. Have you ever heard these people go through, we just have a few here tonight, but the Bible says where two or three are gathered together in my name. Don't do that. Two or three.
Generic.
That's not in it's the generic. Context of just a handful of
right.
That's always been in the context of judgment, right? Always.
Yeah.
You believe me?
I believe.
You question me?
Uh-uh.
Anybody? I don't mind your question, is what I'm trying to show you. Look at Matthew 18. I'll show you something really quick. See Matthew 18, the two or three are in a judgment context, right, just like in 1 Timothy.
Right.
And in both cases, the Old Testament text. That's right. That's where most people are getting it. But where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. That's why I tell you that you can't do just one verse doing scripture. What I try to teach you, you got to eat it.
Yeah.
You got to digest that whole text. If you just read verse number 20 and you say where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Well, that's in the Bible, but that's not the
context.
Way people use it. Go back to 15. Moreover, if thy brother trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, that's what you're after, two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And if you neglect to hear thee, tell it to the church. But you see, the two or three in verse 16 is just like the two or three in verse number 20 is just like the two or three in 1 Timothy.
Right.
In every context, it's a judgment context.
Right.
Look back at the book of Deuteronomy. Let me see if I can find it for you. why I can't do what I'm supposed to do. I think it's Deuteronomy 19. Look at that. Jesus said, we're two or three of them together in my name. Well, that's not what Jesus was talking about. So don't use two or three as some kind of justification for not being small or being small. Go.
Well, that's been going on for years because even the Church of Christ preacher uses that sometimes. So.
Well, you just know in your mind that it's wrong anyhow. You got to remind me. I was teaching Revelation not too long ago, and I was trying to show the people that in Revelation, when in 12, I beheld the dragon kicked out of heaven, that's not the origin of the devil. And somebody raised their hand and said, well, one of our Bible school teachers taught us that. That doesn't mean anything. I mean, it's still wrong. In other words, what you want to do, that's why I said you got to take God's word.
Digest it
for yourself. Read it for yourself. Get a good understanding of it. If you don't get a good understanding, then you don't have anything to change your life and the way you think. You got to get a good understanding of God's
word.
I didn't mean to mess up anything. I was just trying to tell you.
No, that's
not what two or three means. And don't use it like that. When you hear somebody talk about, well, we're two or three together, you say in the back of your mind somewhere, that's still not what the Bible means. And I read it for myself because I read Deuteronomy. I read what Jesus said. And I read what Paul wrote to Timothy. And I see how the Bible is using that. And the way those people are using that is not right. That's all right. I mean, that's all right. You got to learn to think for yourself. Do that. You'll be a good church if you'll learn to read God's word. I'm going to show you another reasons for doing that in just a little while. All right, let me hasten on. Class at Midtown is I give them a sheet, and when we get that sheet, I tell them to go home and read, carefully read, 1st and 2nd Timothy, and write down the things that Paul told Timothy and Titus to do as evangelists. Just write those down. And then write down everything the Bible says an elder is supposed to do.
Right.
Just write it down. And then write. They say, "Well, what it means is he'll depart." Because I've never seen her play a high school game like I've seen her play in our fellowship hall in church right across the hall. But she had one of those yelling coaches who just yell all the time.
Come on, come on, what are you, come on?
Right? You might do this person like that, and they'll look you right back in the face and say, you get off my back.
Yep.
If you do this person like that, her feathers are going to fall.
Right.
So he lost the game by just a couple of points. And he had me so hot. I mean, you lost the game. I'm just telling you. You lost the game.
Right.
And he, well, I'm just talking about the way she, I said, what I'm trying to, I'm not talking about her ability. I know her ability better than you. I'm talking about your ability to get it out of her.
Right.
You can't do a high C like that. All you got to do with a high C is just build them up. You keep them built up. So I play her, if the boys come, we beat the boys all night. Because every time I get the ball, I'm going to pass it to her. Shoot it, baby. I don't care how many times you miss it. Shoot it. Shoot it. Because what's going to happen in a minute is she's going to shoot that and rip it. And she's going to get her confidence going.
That's it.
And once she gets her confidence going, we aren't going to lose any more tonight. And as leaders, we've got to know who these people are and how to get confidence going. We've got to know when to back this guy off a little bit, tell this interacting socializer to go sit down somewhere. This person is a steady relator. You need all of them in the church, right? That's why I say leadership is more than a notion. So, and elders have a pretty strong job. The preacher has, I wanted to read something that I wrote about. That's what I was trying to find. I'll find it here, but is charged in Scripture with preaching the gospel, mm-hmm. ordaining elders, things like setting churches in order, keeping them in order. That's the role of a preacher. He needs to do that. And if your preacher is not going to be allowed to do that, you don't really need a preacher. But I promise you that without him, your church is going to dwindle. Now, which one of those do you think I believe you need in the church? All of them.
Mm-hmm.
And all of them need to stay in their place and in their role. And yeah, give me just a minute to study. Now, you're not a good leader.
Right?
You're not a good leader. And you're going to let your own kids fail if you're not careful. You've got to figure out what's going on in their lives,
exactly.
And their hearts. You're trying to get them up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anybody can condemn them.
Yes.
You take a bunch of beaten down people. I'm going to talk about slavery and segregation. You talk about you take a bunch of beaten down people and just beat on them some more while you think you're leading. I would say humbly, you need to go sit down somewhere.
Yes, you
You're
do.
You're hurting the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I believe you've got to have some strength and discipline and all that. But you can't beat on all the people all the time.
Amen.
Right? You got to help them. Sometimes it's multiple causation. That's multiple. A bunch of things happen kind of at the same time. My mother died. My daddy got sick. And then I missed a bunch of school. And a whole bunch of things happened. And that piled up on me. And I couldn't get through it. You say, well, I got through it. Well, what happened to me didn't happen to you.
Amen.
So you're not the standard.
Right?
Mm-mm.
You're not, well, I'm just strong. You know, I'm strong, then you're tricking yourself.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
That's not happening. There are things that can happen to you way beyond your control.
Yes, sir.
And you can be in another boat tomorrow. So you got to be careful. Now I'm talking to leaders, because these are people that we're leading. These people can have a lot of trouble. But a lot of times, more often than not, it's in that whole family system. So it's a little bit more like this. A, B, C, D, E, and everything in the system is connected. And the backbone to that system is husband-wife relationship. So you got husband, wife, child one, child two, child three, and anybody in that system can upset the homeostasis in that system. Anybody in there can upset the balance. You say, well, not in my case, because you know, my husband and I are just strong. So you're still missing the point. Your husband and you can be real strong,
and
child two gets sick and has to have emergency surgery tonight, and that just changed everything.
Yeah. Right?
And you can't do nothing about it, but deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, leadership. We've got to take our people, understand them, figure out what's really. If you just go through the Bible, say, all right, what is this guy doing? What is this guy doing? What is this guy doing? What is the conflict? You're not going to find a conflict in that. Because God is aimed at making a strong, faithful church that edifies itself in love. That's what he's aimed at. So you're not going to find conflict. So let me just kind of summarize what these people do. And then you can question it, and I'll do whatever I need to do. But I want to save me a little time to show you where some of our problems have creeped in the church from a historical perspective. These guys roll deacons. Best determined, in my judgment, by the meaning of the word itself. This word means deacon, servant. These people are servants of God. All of us are servants. Don't misunderstand that. One thing that I would add here to a deacon that I think a lot of churches need to hear is deacons ought to have charges. Mm-hmm. I mean, specific charges. At least one, some cases more than one. See, I don't like it when you say, I'm a deacon here. You say, yeah, well, what do you do? Mm-hmm. I'm a deacon here.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know that. You told me that the first time I had it. But what I'm asking is, what's your charge?
Yeah.
Right. What are you in charge of? What do you do? Well, I'm the deacons. All right, if you set that up like that, you're running a risk, right? Because if this guy doesn't have a charge, and you get a group of them, they're going to get together. Everywhere I've seen it, where you have too many deacons with no charges, they start trying to act like elders. Or
yes,
tell
they
the
do.
Elders what to do.
Yes, say that.
Give them a charge.
Yes.
Like a good charge.
Mm-hmm.
You're over the benevolent ministry. You're over the evangelism ministry. You have a charge, or you know your church better than I do, so I'm not going to go. But things that we need to get done in this church, and you'd have to decide what those are by studying this church. That's a good function of elders, but deacons ought to have charges and not just function as general deacons.
Mm-hmm.
what do you want me to do? You say, let's say, play like you guys are elders, I don't know. But you say, I say, yeah, I'll serve as a deacon. What do you want me to do? He said, I don't know, we just need some deacons. You don't need no deacon just to have a deacon.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
You don't even need elders just to have elders.
Right.
Right. We need these people for purpose and
right.
understand what they're really doing.
Amen, preacher.
A lot of times you can ask a church, you think you need elders? They say, yeah. You say, what do you need them for? We didn't need elders. You know, well, you don't want to be like that as a church. That's why I was telling you last night that really you'd come out better if you know Kohathite, Merarite, and Gershonite. If you understand how the whole thing is functioning,
right.
you'll be better off.
Right.
All right, if you say elders, if these guys, the elders, say the best way I know to talk about elders, I drew a family up there last night, a little family thing, and as the head of my family, I consider it my responsibility. Think hard now to make sure that everybody in my house develops their fullest potential. So now, play like we are the elders of this church. Here's a task that we have. We've got to make sure that these people are growing and developing. And we've got to make opportunities for them and ways to make sure that these people are growing. We can't just sit here and look at all the dysfunction and say, oh,
mm-hmm.
We got to figure out what to do about that.
Right.
And how do we help that? It's more than a notion. One of the reasons that I tell people that at times people say, "Red, you must be one of the elders at Midtown." Mm-hmm. Or I tell them, "No, I'm not an elder at Midtown. I'm the preacher."
Mm-hmm.
Can I just tell you one thing that got a bunch of people confused?
Mm-hmm.
They think I ought to be an elder for authority. I don't need any authority. I got the authority that God gave me as the preacher.
Mm-hmm.
I don't need. Listen. And one of my dodges for eldership would be that I've had enough trouble trying to raise 9 kids. And then you look at that and say, all right, I've got to make sure all these people develop their fullest potential. Now I'm going to be appointed as an elder, and I've got to look at 15, 20 times that and start trying to figure out what to do with these people. How do I get them growing and developing into what God wants me, wants them to be? Because somehow I've got to help lead all of y'all to heaven.
Amen.
That's right. Now let me tell you, just give you a couple of examples of why I say the whole leadership picture is bigger. It's so much bigger than we want to make it. I'm going to erase this and just give you just a smattering of what I'm talking about. I taught school 20 years, and one thing I learned a long time ago is a kid can come in making an F, and you say, what's the reason? And sometimes it's what we call linear causation. Okay, linear causation. A caused B, caused C, caused D, made the big problem.